at times, the thoughts keep creeping back into my mind. Whilst I have a far better grip than I did on myself back in 2015, where there was 3 nights later in that year, where they almost took my life, I think I grew from it. But I'd be lying if those thoughts keep creeping into my mind. And like I said, whilst I have a better grip on it, those thoughts are just coming back, and they're coming back more often than not, and worse. Not to the extent of what 2015 was, but I'm just trying to find a way to cope with it. And so I thought my life, I've sort of always been alone, really alone. I think because of that, I'm a very private person. I don't express a lot of things, even to my closest friends. And I won't talk about problems that most friends and family would talk about openly, or at least address that situation. But again, I think because I've just been alone, and the way I've been brought up, I just keep to myself. I needed to do something to just keep my mind off it. So here I am in front of a camera, hoisting my thoughts. It is 11:45, almost midnight, on the 1st of July. And I'm going to talk about everything. So, let's start from the beginning. I told you how that I was, it's just sort of been me my whole life. I'm an only child, and a single mother raised me. For the most part. And whilst I love my childhood, there definitely is a lot of negativity surrounding it. So when I was being raised, I was exposed to physical and verbal abuse and pure assault on my mother. And when you're an only child, being looked after by your mother, just your mother, and you see them getting assaulted and abused, you know, to you they're everything. Like, you don't have anyone else, you've got them. I did have my uncle for most of my life, like a great portion of it, so I'm very thankful for that. But I had my father too, but the point is that when a single mother raises you and you're an only child, you look to them as if not even as if, they're just, they are your everything. You know, they, like any mother would, they look after you and put everything on the line for you and do what's best for you. And so when you see them, getting assaulted, screamed at, manipulated, abused. I'm sorry, it's just the memory, like when you talk about it, you can't help but think of those particular memories. And you know, I was very young, you know, I was 4 years old, 6 years old. 8, 10, just around that, even 15, that sort of time period is when most of that happened. And when you're a child, it is just extremely traumatic seeing that. And it sticks with you. Like, those memories haven't faded or decayed in any way. I still remember them as if... the reason why you remember them, again, is because it's so traumatic. And when you're that young and exposed to it, it just... And seeing it happen to, like, pretty much one of the only things that you love, it would just stick with you. So I wanted to start off by saying that there's been a history of traumatic experiences, and you know, my father had depression, and my mother would have panic attacks because of stress, and like, not even like paying bills stress. I mean, that as well, like, we're not super well off, but just unnecessary stress, you know, people stress that, like, that people would put on her for no good reason. It was either way. Anyway, what I'm saying is that the history's there, and so that just naturally came to me. You know, I think that I was like, it would have been a rare chance for me to go through life and be happier than what I am. I think that was that would be a very rare thing to happen. But yeah, what I'm saying is I think I was going to become this way either way. So there's that. There's the beginning portion. And then now I'm going to talk about my worst part. In 2015, I've only ever told my mother this because, again, I'm a very private person. I don't like to discuss those things. And I guess to the people, or if anyone is watching, are questioning, if I was so private, why am I uploading it on a public platform? Admittedly, there's been plenty of videos I've done like this, but I just haven't uploaded them, or I've got them unlisted. Now, I've got plenty of videos that I've been part of that are tucked away and are like public, but I don't talk about or promote it. But I've got videos from pretty much when I was 16. I had a camera at a young age and just sort of went through life with it. And talking to the camera, just talking out loud, I found very therapeutic. And I'll admit, even before I turned this camera on, I was just talking to myself out loud. I'm like, you know what? Screw it. I'm going to do it in front of a camera for the main purpose why I'm having this online. And I'm not using my name. I'm trying to remain anonymous, even though I'm using my face and voice. I just hope that no one that knows me comes across watching this, because I'm probably gonna feel like embarrassed and all that stuff. Just because, and like people be like, there's no reason to be embarrassed. Like that's completely fine to talk about. But it's just because of how alone I am and just what I think. It's just a hard thing to share. I'm sure a lot of people will understand that anyway. So again, sorry, I'm rambling and I'm probably gonna do that a lot. It's gonna be a long video, but the main reason is that maybe if I share a story, it could help someone else. You know, there's plenty of people that I know have uploaded videos talking about their struggles with life, and it's been very inspiring that, you know, someone that had, you know, almost hit rock bottom and, you know, left this world, continue to stay with it and are here to tell that story to, you know, the broken ones alive. And that's a very strong thing, and it's a very brave thing to do. So I figured that if I could help anyone, then that's a good enough reason to have it public. So that's the reason why I'm uploading this and having it public. Again, I'm not going to be using my name, just because I don't necessarily want people that know me to see these videos. But I guess, I mean, it is what it is. What happens, happens. But I guess it's mainly for the people that just, I mean, it's for everyone. Whoever can benefit from this, then good on you. Anyway, so for my time in 2015, yeah. was the first year out of high school. So I was 18 turning 19. And I got my first job that year. And, you know, the first part of it was really good. But I think I slowly became aware that life isn't that good without school, you know, because with school you're always talking to people, and as uncomfortable and anxious as I was, I still look back on it and I miss it. And to this day, I think it's the best time of my life, because everyone's there and it's just, you're just breathing a different air. It's just, and I know I've had a rough childhood, but it's better than what this is. So the first half of that year was fine. But toward the end of the year, I just sort of started to get a little bit of an understanding as how the adult life worked. And that life through, it came at me really hard. Yeah, so it got to a point where I couldn't cope, I couldn't deal with it anymore, and I wanted to leave this world. So I'll go into a bit of detail here, so it might be a bit, I've literally told this once, and I never really plan on telling it again. So for 3 nights in a row, my parents were out, I just had the house to myself as well, and my uncle was out too. So 3 nights in a row, I would go to the kitchen, I'd grab a knife from the knife board, I'd go into my parents' room, and they had these three wardrobe like cupboards that, like, they were like sliding cupboards. So there's like one on the side, one in the middle, and another one on the side, and the middle one had a mirror. So I would grab the side of the middle one as hard as I could, and I had the knife in my other hand at my throat, and I just remember holding that wardrobe so tight, and the knife just, I honestly don't want to recreate it, because I had the knife gripped right at my throat, and I was holding everything so tight, and I was screaming at myself in the mirror, just saying that I was fat, that I was ugly, unwanted, a burden on everyone's life. My friends, my family didn't love me, that I would never amount to anything. I'd be unsuccessful. No girl would want to be in a relationship with me. My music stuff would never be a thing, and that I was a waste. And that just comes back through that entire background that I spoke about, and just with depression generally comes anxiety as well. But I think with depression you inherit traits that you usually wouldn't have. So for instance, one that I had that was really bad was jealousy. Because it was my first year out, you know, people would be having, you know, I'd look to other people and like my friends in year 12 or that I graduated with and see what they're doing. You know, they're out doing uni, you know, traveling the world, you know, being happy, having relationships. And, you know, even to this day, I still do that. And people have, you know, they're having children, they're getting married. So I'm 24 right now. I don't want to give too much. You know what? I was going to say, I don't want to give too much information away as to who I am, but I don't think it matters at this point. And jealousy is a really crap thing to have. And it's not, you know, it's not something that you control. It's like depression. It just comes naturally, and you compare to people. And when you compare to other people, it's when it really gets tough. Because people are out here doing amazing things, you know, moving, like, you know, even moving out and stuff like that. And so, and like, I just, my friends were doing all of these things, and then here I was, like, you know, they were slowly progressing through life, and then I'm, you know, still all the way back here. Admittedly, I've started doing what I've loved, like, what I love, and, but that's another, I might talk about that later, but it just hurts so much when you just see other people not happy. You're not jealous that, oh, you know, why they're happy, I want to be happy, then and them not. I feel like everyone knows what jealousy is. It's just because you can feel great for them, but at the same time you wish you felt that that same feeling as well, you know. And I think another thing that stems from coming alone is, I guess there's a lot of areas in life that I haven't explored yet. I think, for instance, I'm just thinking, I'll talk about it. Like, for instance, I've never really been in a relationship. I mean, I technically have in 2009 for a weekend. So I was like 12, turning 13, and it lasted 3 days. So, I mean, I don't really count that. And like, did nothing. And so think I'm gonna say, I'm sorry how scattered this is, but when you're the way I am right now, you overthink way too many things. You think negatively of yourself, and you think that even if someone doesn't reply to your message, you just feel that they don't want to talk to you, or it can be as small as that. This is water, by the way. So I think that's another thing, I think that I've been by myself for so long that I think that I might like a change in that. But I don't know. Like, I don't know. I think what would make me happy is that if someone could love me as someone, as much as a wife could love a husband, or a husband could love a wife, or whatever. Just, I think if someone could think, like, could love me that much, and I could love them as much, that maybe that would make me happy. I don't know. Like, I guess I'm just trying to find an answer as to how to get happy. And I know there's medication and stuff, but I want my happiness to come from a natural cause, not something as artificial as a pill. So this has sort of been a bit scattered, I realize now, but so I might as well address the point while I'm on it and then get back to the 2015 thing. So okay. There's this girl that I had like a little crush on, and I wasn't going to act on it because of two things. I know I just said that maybe that if I was in a relationship, I'd be happy, but I think ultimately I'm not ready for that. So that was one thing, and two, that she's already in a relationship, and so I wanted nothing to come with that. Even if she was single, I still wouldn't have done anything. But I think that it's just, will I always be this way? Even when an opportunity does arise and it is the right decision, like, how will I know? And will it ever come? I'm not waiting impatiently for anything. I'm just trying to find a way through this mess. So I just want to quickly address that, because that's another thing. I'm just gonna restart this recording really quick. So that's another thing that was on my mind. It's just that, will I, when I'm 10 years old, will I have a house, a partner? Will I have children? Or will I just be the same person? Because I can't do this for much longer. I really can't. Anyway, that's that segment. So that's another thing I've been experiencing, like, throughout this time, is the relationship thing and just my thoughts on that. And so back to 2015. Yeah, so that was a really rough thing. Like, just when you're just like making eye contact with yourself in the mirror and just saying those things, even if they might have an ounce of truth to them. That was a really, really rough time. That's the worst I've ever been, with that knife at my neck. throat. And just, I just remember how close I was to doing it. So it's been 5 years, it'll be like 5 years in. I want to say September it was. I could check, but yeah. So a bit of time has passed, and so I think I've become sort of a little desensitized to telling that story. Not telling that story, but just my connection to that story. Because again, I've only really told it once. I have told it once. So the reason, I just want to create emphasis on just how close I was to doing it. Because that first night happened, and then I'm like, nah, the next day, and like 3 nights of that, and I couldn't do it. And I was so close. The reason why I didn't do it is because I knew deep down that my family did love me. That my friends loved me. And if I were to leave this planet, this world, that people would be hurt by it. Another thing was that I knew there was potential in me. No matter how small it was, it could have been tucked in the corner, buried beneath a bunch of things, and it was just the smallest little glimmer of potential and hope. I think I just knew that I had something, as minuscule as it was, and so I think that that's what ultimately, kept me here. Sorry, I'm just turning on the heater, it's kind of cold. Those were the three worst nights of my life. And I've never been that bad since, but like I said at the start of the video, I've got a far better grasp of myself. But I still, you know, depression isn't, I feel like, something you can just beat, you know? It's not like a cancer where, you know, all the cells can dissipate and, like, you don't have any, like, cancerous growths or cells or, like, sprouts or anything of that nature. It's something just that, it's just a lingering darkness that will stay throughout your life. Maybe. I mean, I'm 24, I'm young, I've still got plenty to learn and plenty to experience, but so maybe I'm just being naive and stupid. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. But I don't know why now, but those thoughts are just coming back. I sort of have these past few months. I think I'm just so worried that things won't work out for me. So I want to touch on some other things with the jealousy thing. Yeah, I was a guy that was going to the gym 7 days a week, just just trying to grow so much. And you know, I was really young and just, you know, this is 2015, and all the, like, throughout the past years, you know, I was just eating the wrong things, and you know, I just couldn't, I just hit a plateau, I just couldn't go anywhere. And so I remember going out one night with my friends, and this is how bad jealousy can run, like, this is how bad it can just ruin you. You know, we were out downtown, and you know, it was just one Saturday night, and then my friend got a compliment from this girl about, you know, his body and just his physique, and that, and jealousy, and like this type of thought process isn't something I would ever like try and relate myself to. It's just not me, and it's greedy to think that someone can get a compliment, and just because you've put in more work or something like that doesn't mean that you should be trying to get a compliment too. Not that I was trying, but it's just like, I think because I just put in so much work and was going so many times and doing all this, just everything I could do, and you know, not get praise for it. Again, that's something that I'm not just I think you know what I mean. Like, I'm not a person that would want praise for doing something good. That's either way, that I got home that night and felt crap and stayed up all night. I'm like, no, you know what? I'm just gonna bulk up hard. So I ate 5,000 calories for the next 2 months, and just the gym was my second home. I mean, it kind of has been this whole time, but at that point, I guess it almost was my home, really. And I got really fat. I mean, not really fat, but I got fat. Because whilst I was eating 5,000 calories, I was eating really bad foods, just ice cream and stuff, just to get those calories in. And when you're fat, and not fat, but when you're uncomfortable with your body, that can bring up a whole new set of problems. That's Charlie. Sorry. Because in the summertime, I would hate how people would be wearing, you know, singlets and shorts, and because I was so uncomfortable with my weight, I would wear a jacket in, like, you know, 30 degree heat, because I wanted to look less bigger than what I was, try and, you know, hide it, create an illusion. And, you know, people say comments like, dude, take off your jacket, you know, it's so hot. And you know, you're out with your family eating dinner, and you just can't be yourself, because you just, you're foreign to yourself. You're just not you. I mean, granted, I was still learning who I was, and like the person that I'm becoming. And I think I still am in some aspects, but I think mostly who I am today is the person that I am. Which is a good thing. I'm proud of the person I am. I think that, sorry, I'm just trying to keep this as straight as I can. I don't want this to be off center. I mean, it looks straight. Yeah, no, I'm proud of the person I am. But I just think that I need to get over a few things. And that's going to be with time. And so, yeah, that was just another thing, because a gym is a big part of my life, something that I've always loved doing. Well, not always, sounds like I've been doing it since I was eight, you know, I guess since I legally could, you know, even before I legally could at gyms, I would still work out with weights that I would find under my uncle's bed or wherever I could find weights. So that was just another thing I would get jealous about, and the worst part about that is like that affected, I mean obviously mentally is an extreme case, but for it to also affect you physically is something big too. So that's a sort of, I guess, if people wanted to know my story, that's a lot. Like, that's the big portion there. There's plenty of details and other things that could be said, done. But I just want to say that right now I'm doing what I love. Yeah, I've always wanted to be a musician. And that's something that I'm doing. Again, I don't want to be too direct, because I want to sort of remain as anonymous as possible, just because, I don't know, I already told you, yeah, and I'll say a few more things, and like things that like that really got to me is like when I would message some girls, and I had no intention of like flirting, it was just a kind message, and so I'm worried that once this video goes public, because I'm gonna be changing the name of it, and I guess I'm mainly saying this just because I have left a comment on some people's videos. And I think the reason, again, because I overthink things and think that, you know, what if they think that, you know, I was flirting with them, and just, you know, I feel like it's so hard just to be nice and, well, to, this, it's going to sound bad, but I just feel like it's kind of a bit hard for me to be nice to women, because they might just think that, oh, you know, this guy's just trying to hook up with me. I mean, sure, there's probably plenty of cases where that's true. Probably most cases, to be honest, but... and there have been cases with me, but... For the most part, I'm just... being polite, but I've sort of learned to sort of... just not really bother with that anymore. Or at least, a lot less. So yeah, if someone did happen to come across a comment on their video... that I left, I was just being genuine. I had no hidden agenda behind that. Because I'm just using this one as an example. I won't be saying any names, but she had put up like all these like videos, and that they're very therapeutic for me, because like I said recently in the past few months, it's just, those thoughts are just sort of creeping back up, but her videos were very therapeutic. You know, she was someone that had, you know, suffered through some stuff of that too, and so seeing her deal with it and, you know, make her videos public, it made me feel better at myself that, you know, there are people like me that are feeling the same way, and I guess I just feel a bit more accepted. Yeah, again, this comes from a whole background of traumatic events and me by being just sort of a loner most of my life, so that's why I think the way I do. But yeah, that's just, I guess, to protect myself in case, like, oh my god, this guy was like trying to, no, again, I'm overthinking that, and I didn't even have to say that, but there's just so many things that I could address, and I'll just say, the one thing I'm worried about now is my music stuff not taking off. Because it's a big thing. when you put, you know, it's the number one thing I've always wanted to do in life, and like when you put so much time and money and work, and like it has been super draining on my being, like we had to deal with a lot of stuff. Even before I was in this band, I had to deal with a lot of things, and it was just, it was honestly just terrible. And I think that, you know, I was, after failure, countless failures, I honestly can't give you a number of how many times I've tried to start a band up and get that going. And I just, it was so draining, and I just, what almost killed me was just seeing all these other bands, you know, get all this recognition in public. It's like, you know, that could have been me. Again, it's a jealousy thing, and I'm past that point, because like we're on to actually some really good things. But I just, yeah, I think I gave it just like one final effort to put my all into this last, you know, attempt. With life, I think you should always keep attacking your project, no matter how many times you fail at it. And I definitely don't think that you should go into, or have a headspace of saying, okay, this is my one final effort to do it. That's not what it's about. Because if that was your final effort, then what if the next one had have been it, you know? What if you had have tried one more time and gotten somewhere? That, like, you can't let yourself do that, putting like this blockade on your potential. That's, you're hurting yourself way too much, and you don't deserve it. You absolutely don't. That's, when something was so close, it might have looked so far away at that point, but from another perspective, it was extremely close, and all you had to do was just try one more time. And you don't know until you get there. And it's gonna be hard, it's gonna be draining, it almost may take your life like it did mine. But I kept trying, and I got somewhere. And I'm happy and proud of what I'm a part of. No matter how much it took of me, you know, it's there, you know. So I think that ultimately this whole video is, again, I the main reason why it's public is just so if I could help anyone. And I guess from my experience, what I can say is that when you're going through these struggles, there's going to be many paths you can take, and it's going to take you a long time. It may take you months, even years, like it did for me. And it's not necessarily finding the right path, but it's about knowing which ones not to tread. I think that if things get that bad for you, that you start to look at abusing a substance, like any form of drug, like you know, obviously very extremely unhealthy drugs and really poor habits, you know, drinking alcohol and even resorting to, you know, some of the worst ones out there. That's definitely one of the darker roads out there. That, I mean, people are different, people cope in different ways, and people will resort to that. But it's just a matter of persistence, determination, and courage. And so, after my three nights in 2015, I thought I would tell my mother. Because I didn't know what to do. I was lost and I don't know what was on. I had no idea. So went out there. I said, "Hey, mom, like, can I talk to you?" And that was extremely hard to be able to try and open up to someone. And she said, "Yep, that's fine." And I remember, like, she's like, you know, I jumped out of the shower and like, she's like, "Oh, did you want to talk to me?" And I'm like, "Oh, you know what? Nah, that's fine. That's cool." I think that happened a couple of times, right, where I pulled out and I'm like, "Nah, you know what? Can't do it." I thought, you know what, I've got to, I have to tell someone. And so we went out the front and sat on this wooden bench. Went out the front of the house, I mean. And I told her, you know, those three nights and what I did. And, you know, she was in tears. And, you know, she said what any amazing mother would say, you know, like, I can't remember what she said exactly, but she said, "If you were to kill yourself, I'd have no idea what to do." Something like that. Because, like I said, I knew if I did, I would really hurt her. Because it's been us throughout the whole life. And she was in tears, and she just, whilst that was a bad time, I can't express enough how much better I felt just saying that. I'm just going to restart the recording really quick. Like, people say, "Oh, it felt like such a weight off my shoulders," but like, it literally felt like that. Like, I just felt like I was just literally just weighed down. And I told her about it, and it literally felt like I could breathe because all this weight was just lifted. And I remember some time after, she could tell that, like, as soon as I told her that, she was like, "Yeah," like, I could immediately tell, like, that you were just happier and more comfortable. And again, she did what any mother would do, I think. You know, I remember, I'm like, "Okay, yeah, cool, I told you. Alright, yeah," we talked for a good bit. I'm feeling pretty good, I'm gonna go to the gym. and she, I remember going out of the gym and like, her car was there. Like, she would follow me for the next like few days. She would just like, I noticed as I was going to places, I think I was unemployed at that point, I think. No, I was employed. Yeah, I was. I was working at Subway. yeah, she would follow me, like, it was as if I had like this like secret service with me. I would just like be walking on the path and I would just like see like around the corner down there, I just see a car just poking me out of the corner. I'm like, "I can see you, mom." But she didn't want to leave me by myself. So that was one of the best things I could do, is just to, you know, get the courage to talk about it. I think that, you know, for anyone that's experiencing similar things, that look, talking about someone that you're comfortable with may take you a bit of time to build up to it, but for me, it really helped. At that point in time, it really helped. So, I guess, ultimately, the advice I'd give is to just be persistent, focus on yourself, understand, you have to understand that what you think of yourself is most likely untrue. If you're a good person that has experienced these types of things, like, and you just, you're torn between yourself, you know, you're at war with your own person, telling yourself things that you're not, because it's just the way you look at life. So I think you need to pull yourself, just take a step back and understand just take a basic perspective of yourself. It's like, okay, I don't like this part of my life. How can I change it? And there might be one thing, but there could be a multitude of other things that affect it as well. And I think that's how it becomes overwhelming. It's just like there's all these things in front of you that you have to address. It's just like, let's start by doing one. And getting clarity, just talking about it, is a really good thing. Again, I have told you how private my life is and the person, like, just like how alone I've been. And even now, I don't desire to talk about the minuscule things that affect my life in a negative way to people. But if I'm that private and that lonesome, and I'm still able to somehow muster up the courage to speak up about it to someone that I love, then I think that you can find within yourself that that's possible too. And maybe that's step one for you. So that might be one of the paths that is a correct one, and is the way I sort of viewed it is this massive like box, and there's all these one like these paths that stem that are negative, and you know this path down here, you might think that, oh, it's a straight shot, it's a straight easy shot that to success and happiness, but it's not. This path up here doesn't stem from, it's not a straight line, you know? You might have to go through all these negative paths to get to like stem into this one, or you know, you might take a couple of negatives and then start to do some right things, and then who knows, you might hit a new personal low, like rock bottom for you, and it could be months, it could be years. But success isn't just a straight shot. No one in life just can just start from here and it's just all success and happiness from the get-go. No. I mean, there's exceptions, right? But that's how I viewed it. That's how I still do view it. So, yeah, I guess here I am with the story told. I'm not looking for sympathy. Again, this is almost 5 years ago. The main reason why this is public, I think I've said this 3 times now, or at least this will be my third, is just that maybe it can help someone. And if it helps some, like one person, then good on you. Because like, there's nothing more in, like, I have felt an extreme happiness this year, one of the things that makes me most happy is when I my band plays a show. I just have this feeling of just being embraced by love. And as like cringy as it may sound and like soft-hearted and just a bit mushy, you know, I would just feel happy. Yeah. I guess it was just so rare that I was that happy that it was just like this overwhelming, ethereal experience. And yeah, I've gotta sort of promote the band on like social media, and I'd always get so anxious, you know, writing, and I still do, like, I'm not really a fan of it. But at the same time, if you sort of want, when it's my number one thing that I want to do and you want it to get off the ground, you kinda, I mean, you have to, right? So it's something you gotta suck up and deal with it. I won't lie, I really don't like it. But after a show and stuff like that, like, I'll just tuck my keyboard, I'll just sit there and just, you know, and bang out a post and just be, yeah, again, I just feel so happy and loved, and just, it's, sometimes happiness is just the weirdest feeling when you haven't felt it for so long. You just don't know what to do, like, you just can't stop talking, and you can't stop smiling, and, you know, it's so, sometimes you just forget what happiness feels like, and it's amazing, the feeling, and it's just a basic feeling that someone should have every day. Yeah. And yeah, I mean, again, that's pretty much all I've got to say. There'll be your good days and your bad days, you know, like, for instance, like, I played that show and was happy for weeks, and then, you know, all it takes is just waking up, you know, you just wake up and you just like, wow, today is not it, and you just do nothing, you stay in bed just doing nothing because you're anxious. And I mean, personally, I don't really have friends that I hang out with down here. Actually, very recently, I had a friend move back down from Ballarat, so that's really good. But yeah, I don't really have that outlet of like, oh, hey man, like, do you wanna go hang out and like go for a walk or something? Until, yeah, like 2 weeks ago. So, and we're like gym buddies now, so that's really cool. But yeah, having that luxury of just going for a walk with a friend is immense on your soul. So that was another thing, really, is I never really had people I could hang out with. Wait. Oh, crap. I just realized I said Ballarat. That just gives away more of what, who I am. Oh well, I said it. So I think that's it. That's my story told and how I coped with it. I personally didn't turn to drugs. I never really abused any alcohol. I found the gym to be very therapeutic, and writing lyrics as well. That's actually where some of my work comes from. But the gym for me was extremely therapeutic, and I think that the reason why I call it my second home is just not only because I spent a lot of time there, but for what it did for me, mentally mainly. It was just, when you can just apply it yourself to something that you love, and it gives you something back in return, then it's just, it really is it really can be a saving grace. But yeah, people are different. People will turn to those bad habits. But yeah, I've told you my story, how I coped. Again, there's details that I won't get too, I guess, too close to. But yeah, that you've pretty much heard that portion, the major bits of it. So I guess I'd end it here. If this helps anyone, I'm extremely grateful for that. I don't necessarily plan on having a lot of people watch this. It's just, I get to talk to someone, or at least something, a camera. And if people watch it, then I'm very grateful for that. And if it helps them, I'm extremely thankful, grateful, and just everything under the sun, because that means so much to me. And happiness is just such a... It should be a right, you know. But for some of us, it's a privilege. Yeah. Anyway, I think I've given more information than I wanted to. So I'll just say that my name is Tom McNulty. I'm in the band Tides Collide, and that's what I've put my heart and soul into. And I don't know where it will go, but I'm gonna do my everything. I'm gonna do my everything to do what I can for that band, and that's the plan. So thank you for watching. Goodbye.